Marriage Broker Auntie presents Behind the Scenes. This is an audio series documenting the lives of happily married couples who've committed to spending their every day building healthy relationships. Growing up, we've listened to countless stories that end with meeting your soulmate, getting married, and living happily ever after. But is that all to relationships? We're here to find out more. We hope to unravel marriage through stories of real relationships. I'm your host, Priyanka Bharadwaj, founder and CEO of Marriage Broker Auntie, which is a matrimonial advisory and relationship coaching service. What you're about to hear is an unscripted conversation with a couple who graciously come forward to share their relationship story.
I'm Javani, this is Abhishek, and we go by Jan and Abhi, if everyone calls us that. We met in college, so we've known each other for like 20 years now. I'm 37, he's 36, so we've like known each other for more than half of our lives right now. I'm a data scientist. I work with a management consulting company.
I'm Abhishek, he said we can call me Abhi. I work as a product person in a tech company in Bangalore. I'm a dad to a 9-year-old lab and an 8-month-old human.
My guests today are Janani and Abhishek. They're both from Mambalam in Chennai and now live in Bangalore with their babies, Bam Bam, a 9-year-old Labrador, and Raman, their 9-month-old son. Janani is a data scientist and Abhishek works in product management. They first met in engineering college in early 2000s. They've known each other for almost 2 decades, of which they've been married for 1. They're both opinionated hotheads who are as similar as they're dissimilar, fight like cats and dogs, but always have each other's backs and fiercely protect their little world. Like Joel and Clementine from Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, they say they're convinced that they will find their way back to each other, even if their memories have been erased.
We've known each other for almost 19 years, met in the first year of college. It's a funny story, actually. So you used to have these
engineering college.
It wasn't ragging, especially. We used to play pranks on each other, right? So we had dares for each other in the bus. So I was dared to go and recite ABCD backwards to one, some random row in the front, in the bus. And she was there in that row.
I had no idea what was going on. This random lanky dude just suddenly pops up and says something really fast and then disappears. I didn't even realize that he was saying ABCD.
And then we happened in class for the next 4 years.
We weren't together at that time.
Seeing each other at the college, it was in 2005-06-ish. We got married in 2011, I would say.
Yeah.
Very bad with years. Very bad with years.
It just all feels like a blur. So,
can you talk to me about your relationship in terms of different stages of it? Because you've been together a long time. You were dating, then you got married, then you got a pet together, then you have a child now.
We keep talking about this, but I feel like we've both been dating different people in the same relationship, because each of us changed so much in the course of the years we know each other. So I feel like the people we are now.
We keep joking that it's like six different people in this relationship, right?
So the three distinct couples in the relationship. So I started meeting each other, 17 we met each other, I think we started dating in 21, then 26 we got married, 35, 36 right now. I'd say when we first got to know each other, very young, very naive. I don't think, as we liked each other, we liked talking to each other, we liked each other's company. That's what we wanted to explore and see where we went. We had no plans or ideas beyond that at that point in time.
And we were all kids, right? Like, we were still living in our parents' homes, and we were in Chennai and taking the college bus, coming back. That was it. It was a very closeted world. Then we moved to the US to do our master's.
So after we finished our master's, we both moved in together in the US. Mm. So I think the moving in was the first big change in our relationship. Yeah. Sharing the same space, was a huge, huge change. We didn't expect. I think most people start saying change after their marriage. So marriage is, and that kind of synonymous for most people. Mm-hmm. For us, being together before the marriage. So marriage itself wasn't the biggest deal for us. Moving in together was the biggest change in dynamic for us.
What did you learn about each other that you didn't already know? That kind of required a little bit of adjustment, of flexibility on both sides.
Yeah, I think the first thing that we moved in together was around just the state, share the system of how she likes to keep the house. I'm still having trouble with it today, to be honest. I've changed, but not to the extent that she'd be happy with. Putting things back where I find them, or things having a place for its own, or I was closing the closet doors when I opened them. So from basic at that, I think that's where our biggest revelation was about each other at the point in time. It should.
A very classic sort of initial friction in living together. Very, very rooted in, you know, our gender conditioning. All of that it took a little bit of adjustment. But what was actually very interesting, I think, about living together is we realized that we were with each other all the time, but we also enjoyed each other's company. It was surprisingly really nice to share space because we met at a time when we were young enough that we hadn't formed these really unshakable habits.
More recently, especially now because you've just had a child, have you learned anything new about each other that has taken some making peace with? Because that's another big life stage, right?
I think really just parenting style. We've learned something about each other's parenting styles. We've started realizing that we're bringing our own baggage about the way we were parented.
I don't think it's new in the sense that it's not shocking. We expect each other to have done this, given knowing what each other. For example, knowing what I told you about her organization skills and how she is. Even with the parenting, she's a fantastic mother, and she's planned in every which way. Every item that she's bought for our child has been researched and planned and meticulously done. I'm not surprised about it, but it's something that we have seen as parents in this form before.
Does this difference in personality affect your relationship in any way?
Because we come from very drastically different approaches, I'd say it starts with a lot of conflict for the most part. Right? It starts with a lot of conflict and a lot of arguments and when we compete, it's heated.
Yeah,
it's
not a lot of
it's neighbors calling the cops kind of.
And so, we've known each other a long time, right? So we know exactly how to hurt each other also.
Right? So it's very heated.
I don't know if this is the example you want to set
very,
for you.
Very personal.
No, this is useful, right? Because we also have that. But every time you're having these heated arguments, you think you're alone.
And we both won't give in. He's very aggro and I don't know, straight out aggro. And
people think I'm the nicer guy because I don't conflict out loud as much. I tend to give the vibe that I'm easy to get along, nicer guy because of that. But actually, I'm just seething inside. I'm just quietly seething inside, right? So it starts a lot of conflict, personal, but always for me, I think we end up in a way better place than we started.
How do each of you deal with conflicts? Do each of you have your own style?
I operate in a very rule-based manner, right? Like for me, if you do something to make me pissed off, just say sorry, mean it, convince me that you mean it, do something nice. I need these things in order for me to move on. And for him, we need to be able to hit pause. He has what I call these stages of grief through which he processes a fight. He needs to go through that. He has this denial all the way through to acceptance, and he needs a time to be pause. So I think instead of making the other person jump through hoops and figure out what you want, we've reached a point where it's just better to be explicit in terms of boundaries.
Got it. Can you give me an example of a typical conflict and how you guys normally process it?
We had this conversation around, should we buy new stuff or should we get secondhand stuff from us? That's all it was. Okay.
Snowballed
and blew up into a day and a half, I'd say, of our fight. It should last a little longer. We don't Because it is a process. We can fling that each other from very long time.
We have
a lot of ammo about each other for a very long time.
I held on to that one like 15 years.
So it just goes on for a really long time for us.
So this one just like, you know, just raked up dirt from elsewhere, right? Yeah. So it's so nice to be able to, you know, it's so good for the earth and all that. And I'm like, look, I grew up poor, okay? And I had all sorts of handed down stuff. I am not having handed down stuff for my kids.
And then she's like, you know, you're a hypocrite. Because you said this for this, what about that thing you bought the other day that was not, you know, like, you know, is this not too much? It's poking logical scores in my argument. So I think each of these arguments in some way kind of shift our opinion one way or the other. But it is really, in that point in time, it feels like the entire world is like, you know, like shelter, the bomb happening.
But with this one, right, what ended up happening was ate humble pie and I, you know, came back and I said, look, I overreacted. I have some baggage. I called him entitled. I was like, you're so entitled. The only people who think being poor is charming is people who've never been poor a day in their life. And finally, you know, we just sort of met in the middle where we're like, okay, certain things, it's really okay. Pre-love is okay. And it took me a while to realize that it was my baggage that was actually leading me to react so poorly. And I think it goes a long way for Abhi, for someone to go reflect and come back and say, you know what? I thought about it. You're right.
The fact that both of you have a process to go through this means that both of you go back, reflect a little bit and come back and negotiate something that works for both of you, right?
And also, I think there has been some help. So we've been in therapy for a while now. Individually, we're hoping to get therapy as a couple also over a period of time. That helps a lot individually. Because
to be objective.
Most times, the problem is not each other, but our baggage brings it into this, right?
Yeah, individual therapy really helps people see their own relationships so differently. While therapy is not taboo today and people realize that you actually use therapy as a tool to enrich your own relationship. It isn't like you're having a divorce, that's why you're going to a therapist. For people to know that this is more commonplace than they think it is useful, because you will go get help whenever you feel stuck.
Place this kind of burden on one person, right? Like where you're angry with them, but also you, the other person you talk to resolve an anger is just untenable. So what ends up happening is you talk to your therapist and then you start seeing things in a different light. It's very hard for me to see my own baggage. If he points it out in the middle of a fight, it just snowballs.
So tell me one thing. What was life like before you guys tried therapy and after? What has changed?
I think for me, so I won't bore you with the details, but you know, the last decade has been a very, very challenging year for me. I've lost both my parents. You know, in long-term relationships, that happens, right? You go through these really challenging times. For me, where therapy has helped is in any other situation, it's very difficult for your partner to know how you feel. Like everybody realized is if you're going through something difficult, it's not malice, but they tend to say something or do something that sets you back in your journey a little bit. You need that space to really think through your grief and process what's going on. I think for me, the biggest thing with therapy is for both of us to have that space so that, you know, Abhi can help me go through what I'm going through.
A lot of people expect their partners to just jump in and take care of them when they're going through a very difficult time without realizing that the grief that you're experiencing is personal. It is something that you have to deal with on your own, and your partner can support you, but they can't take the entire burden of making you feel better, right?
Yeah, and I'm the sort of person who's not super in touch with my feelings. I like tend to internalize, clam. It was Abhi who made me go to therapy too. Even he has much better EQ than I have. I'm a lot more like, how do I turn this into a problem and just fix it? So it really helped me have that kind of perspective. And showing up for therapy, like there was a period of time when he would just be like, no matter what happens, I'm taking this one and physically taking her to the therapist, waiting outside, making sure she goes and getting her back. And that is much more powerful than actually trying to be there for a person in ways that you can't be.
That's awesome.
Okay, we'll quickly shift to happier things. What are vacations like? Do you guys like to travel? What's that like?
We travel a lot. We travel together most of the time.
During our trip to Romania, what happened was we were going to spend a day in Paris, but then there was some riot.
There was a strike happening in Paris at the point in time, so all the metros were shut.
So we spent the entire day in the airport.
So it was in the airport. So that airport also gave us our family name, interestingly. So our son doesn't carry our names. His name is Naman, but his last name is not mine or hers. He came with a new name. It's called Mavilam.
It's a locality
we both grew up in called Mambalam. Mambalam was called Mavilam a long time ago because the palm trees or whatever it was. So, the airport layover,
we have a kid. I mean, it just feels so patriarchal to for the kid to automatically take your name, although I'm doing all the work, obviously. So it just started off as a joke, and we were thinking about what do we have in common. Like, Mambalam is common.
And I was like, actually, not a bad idea. We figured out what we're doing.
Cool, awesome. I know you guys do a lot of activities together, but are there things that you guys do on your own that you don't like each other's interference?
So this one's a raging extrovert. Okay, I need, you know, like fuel after
recharge.
Social,
after, yeah.
Yeah, I need to recharge. I need alone time to recharge. So I spent the first few years of our relationship trying to just like being the cool girlfriend, going out, and it just drained me. And after a while, I was just like, you know what? You go out and report back on the external world. Just let me know what's going on. I'll just be inside, right? I really need that. In fact, during the weekends, if you meet too many people, I need alone time.
I know that now I'm packing plans. So I know for a fact that there is a limit. A fungible limit, but it's a limit. I know the limits. So then we meet too many people and they're like, it's fine. So what? I'm going to go meet them right now by myself. You chill here. So a lot of times I go to the park by myself. I meet my friends there. Our friends there. She wouldn't come. Like, you know what? I curl up in a corner, read a book, listen to a podcast. I'll do my thing. You go bake in the sun, get energy and come back.
Right. It's so sweet that you guys understand your differences and just accommodate each other and let each other be.
Oh, it's a journey.
I'm sure, right? Yeah, and I think it's important to know that it's a journey, right? When you see two people who are so different, you're like, is this the right person? Can I spend the rest of my life with this person? Is the first question that kind of pops in your head.
Yeah, when you're young and naive, you think, you know, it's like this, like relationships are about these two people who are, you know, just meant to be together, like they just fit, right? It's nothing like that. You realize it's not what you are, it's what you do. You have to keep at it.
Working at it.
It's just constantly in motion, right? It's not something that you just, that just clicks together. And I think that took a while to
understand. Obviously still working on it. But I think it took a while to, I think you're right. Initially when you spoke about the idea of why the podcast exists, you know, I've mentioned there. All you see about marriage are either in movies, books, or whatever else it is. I see the happy ever stories, and you know, and why it's so difficult for us just get basics out of the way. Like, you know, why are we arguing about simple things? Are we not meant to be? Are we wrong for each other? Then you're like, you know what? This is normal. A good relationship is how it works. It's not the opposite of how we think it is.
I think I'd be more worried if we stopped fighting than if we fight at this point, right? Like, really, if you have the fight in you, that means, I don't know, I think it's good news.
Yeah, absolutely. What would you say is one of your most romantic memories so far?
I still remember this one thing. So we were in college in Sriperumbudur, and then we used to try to hitch rides and come back from college back to the city. But the college buses are only in the evening. So sometimes when we, you know, get away and we want to get away in the middle of the day, go somewhere, right? Hitch rides, right? And we were sitting in this car. I don't know if you remember this. Mm-hmm. So we would all pack into this car to get the ride back to the city. I was really short. So almost always, I am really short. So I'm always the person that ends up sitting on someone's lap, right? So I was sitting on his lap. And you know how the door handle has like this place where you hold it, right? My head was right there. It was a bumpy ride. Then I realized he had sort of, you know, put his hand there so that my head doesn't bump up against it. And he did that so casually, just as a friend. I think that's my all-time favorite memory of us together.
So this birthday of mine was last year in the middle of the pandemic and all. We got a new, we purchased a new house in Bangalore, it's a Whitefield. We're new to Bangalore in general. So we've been living in Kormangal for the time. Whitefield seems like a very alien concept to us. It's like buying a house in Ooty, not being Ooty, Ooty. I haven't been to Whitefield, to be honest. Right? So we're a little apprehensive about the purchase. So, but this birthday, what she did was the same property has a sister property next door, same area. So she booked like a day for us in the clubhouse of the property for this birthday. So we signed the lease or the sale agreement on my birthday this year. I got to spend a day in the property with her and then kind of figure out how our lives would be if we moved there sometime next year. And it was lovely. I loved it. I loved the life. I loved imagining what life could be there when we moved there. And she got it all organized, didn't tell me anything, just got everything done. So we tried ordering Swiggy, what restaurants are there, how does life look like from there. So you know, like the taste of it one day in from Whitefield. Really sweet on our birthday. So we really had a nice thing.
While you guys are describing this thing, there are lots of like good, big memories, memorable events, but there are also lots of like little things. I think of marriage as just a giant bowl of curd rice. So it's comforting. Sometimes there's this garnish that makes it interesting, little things. And then sometimes there are pickles, right?
It's not like, you know, it's not like biryani. You can't have it every day. But you only eat biryani and then it's like curd rice is so underrated.
So maybe it's similar. You can't like carry out like a hot romance right now. You're like too old for that.
Yeah, I feel like if I had met someone right now, my radar is just so different. Like the crap that we tolerated from each other when we were much younger, it's through the roof. But right now, we are too old for this.
If you were to add any parting notes about your learnings about marriage or anything that you want to say to each other, what would it be?
People who have children early into their marriage are perfectly happy, and we know a lot of people who are. But I think parenting together is just such a difficult thing that I'm so glad we put it off until we got to a point in our relationship where we know how to fight and how to walk away from it. I think one thing I'm really thankful to Abhi for is one of the things that he's always been steadfast about is he's always wanted to adopt. And it never like occurred to me that that's something we should do. He's just so thirsty for social justice, right? So he's always recycling, always conscious of things. So initially when he told me this, I was like, why can't we have our own children? I love biological children. It's so nice to see a version of yourself. And I think I never really thanked him for, you know, talking me into this because we're hoping to get a child soon through adoption.
I did say adoption, which is not the right thing to do, but I think I really understood what it means to have a child, to have responsibility. Because I'm a very emotional person, so I say things to save them, but I don't really understand what it means to become committed, to figure out, be a dad. I think she's always very prepared, extremely, and like it's possible she's gone through every video on YouTube about parenting and about being a mother in general, like across the place, I think. She's read so much and she gives me digital information on the way, school of thought, whatever it is, right? That's a very grateful for the fact that I think I'm a better dad and we're better parents because of what she brings to the table.
It takes a lot for people to feel so secure and confident in their relationships to be able to discuss it with a complete stranger. So I feel so honored to have been able to listen to Jan and Abhi's story today. We definitely didn't get into the details of it, but my biggest learning from this conversation today is that sometimes support comes through little gestures, such as taking your better half to a therapist just so that they get the support they need to feel whole on their own. As Janani said, relationships aren't just about who you are, it's about what you do because everything is constantly in motion. You negotiate just a little bit every day, and over time, you build a relationship that is customized just for you and your partner. Thank you for listening to Behind the Scenes. These conversations are available on the Marriage Broker Auntie channel on YouTube and Spotify. Please subscribe to our channel if you haven't already done so, so you can have access to future episodes as soon as they're out. Much has been said about how we meet our partners, but very little about how we build relationships with them. So if you think this conversation could inspire someone you know, don't forget to share this with them. If you'd like to follow us on social media, you can find us on Instagram and Twitter. You can also go to our website marriagebrokerauntie.com, Auntie with an IE, to learn more about this project and the work we do.